He's asked me to send through mail. Okay, I will send the mail quickly.
Sashi, allow everyone to join in.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Good morning, Philip, sir.
Good morning. Is this Sashi speaking?
Yeah, Sashi is speaking, sir.
Okay, good morning, Sashi. Hi. Sorry?
We'll start in a few minutes, sir. After five to 6 minutes.
Yes, of course. It's 25 past now, at least over here. It's almost 9 o'clock, five to nine over there, I assume.
Yeah, so. 5 to 11 is there. Sir.
Perfect. Can you hear me well?
Yeah, I can hear you, sir.
Oh, perfect. I will share my screen now.
After a few minutes, sir.
Okay. Yeah, no worries.
First time you do the intro about you.
Okay. No worries.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
Yeah. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, sir. And shall we start the session?
Good morning. Good morning. I think it's Sashi. For me, it's okay to start.
Yeah. Shushan, sir, I'm starting, sir.
Sorry?
No, sir. Another, my group leader.
Yes, Sashi, we can start. And thank you so much, Philip, for joining today and sharing your knowledge with us. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Shall I start up? Can I start sharing my screen?
1 second, 1 minute, sir. Just one minute.
Okay.
Yeah, about you. And good morning, everyone. And joining for New Delhi Salesforce Impact Salesforce Day again. And today, here with us, Philip Thijs. He's a founder of iTech Academy. And he is an independent Salesforce consultant for past 15 years. And the website for his website was http://itechacademy.in. I will share in the chat once again. And this is me, R. Sashi Kiran, Salesforce developer at Deloitte USA. And I am a 2X certified admin and PD1. And these are our New Delhi Salesforce Twitter and handles, New Delhi Salesforce Group handles, website, and Talent Central Group. And we call it as Impact Salesforce Saturday from past few years. And we conduct sessions on every Saturday on Salesforce things to share knowledge and to gain knowledge.
Sashi, you are not audible for me, I guess.
Are you able now? Are you audible now, sir?
Yes, you are.
Yeah, I think mute it was.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay then. And this was one of the Impact Salesforce Saturday. Another initiative was Let's Implement, where we will connect some real life skills, and it will help for jobs in Salesforce ecosystem through Talent Central. And Talent Central has given many opportunities to many students. And Mentorship Central, you can go to the website and fill up that form for mentorship. Journey to Salesforce is one of the biggest thing for Salesforce to apply for jobs and to attend the exam of PD1. You can join through that Telegram group, Salesforce Devs India, and top contributors of New Delhi Salesforce groups are these candidates. And these are the handles, Twitter handle and YouTube and everything for Salesforce, New Delhi Salesforce group. And every week we will conduct these sessions, and after a few days we will upload those in YouTube. You guys can watch there again. And thanks for CloudVandana and Graves for as a sponsor to us, New Delhi Salesforce group. And thank you, everyone. Over to you, Philip, sir.
My turn, Sashi.
Yeah, your turn.
Okay. Oh, I was already very, very, very impatiently waiting to start. So I'll start with sharing my screen.
Sure.
There we go. I hope everyone can hear me well. And as you can see, a very familiar sight already. I've got my Salesforce. Even you can see.
No? Yeah, we can see, sir.
Okay. Yes. Okay. So again, a very, very familiar, familiar sight that you can see. I always work Salesforce day and night, and since I'm based in Europe, south of Europe currently, it's quite early over here. And nevertheless, Salesforce is logged on. Let's pull up some slides, and let's have a look at the session that we have this hour. As I mentioned, it's still quite early over here, so I might seem a bit clumsy with my buttons. Good. So welcome everyone to this session. As you can see, my name is Philip Thijs. I'm a business owner. I've been working for Salesforce for many hours already, many years already. And as you can see, we are going to have a look at security, organization security. When I was asked to do this session, first of all, I was of course very happy and very honored to do this session. But one of the big questions was which topic should I choose, because there are so many, as you know, as everybody knows, the Salesforce is massive, and I will give you a quick explanation on what I do with Salesforce. I do quite a lot with Salesforce. But there are many topics to choose from, complex topics, easy topics, in-depth, low level, topics that can take days to explain, topics that are easy to explain. So I've decided to pick a topic that I consider very, very or extremely important myself, a topic which is not very often well understood. Often people are a bit afraid of, as it seems, people are a bit afraid of security or diving into security. Partially, I think, because Salesforce is still considered a business software, and many people working with Salesforce have never seen a database. So when they hear the word security, they quickly run away. So it's not a difficult topic to explain. That was one of the reasons why I chose it. And it's extremely important. As a Salesforce administrator, as a Salesforce developer, if you don't master security well enough, it can be reason enough to be fired, because security is what protects our sensitive data. Yeah. So I thought it was a good choice or a good idea to have a short for some of you, it will be a review on security. Some will already understand it. But I hope the lesson for these people is that although it is easy, it is extremely important in any organization. On the other hand, I thought it was also low level enough. I didn't know my audience. I didn't know you guys and girls. So it's something that is accessible for someone who's not very knowledgeable in Salesforce, but also even for developers. I've met many experienced administrators that still don't know security or the details of security well enough. So I think good choice, security, a good choice for us, because it is needed, the knowledge is needed, a good choice for organizations, because organizations are often lacking security. Security towards their data. Good. So let's continue. A bit about me. I saw that picture that you showed of me, Sashi. Where did you get it from? I look forward to. I know Sashi. Yeah. I know Sashi. It's a joke. remember from the training, I tend to make jokes sometimes.
Yeah, yeah.
I think it is quite a nice picture. Thank you. Good. So about me. So Philip Thies, my background. I graduated as an engineer somewhere. It might not seem very business minded, but I also have a commercial approach, of course, and some commercial background or economical background. But my main background is engineer. Graduated from university halfway of the 90s, so already quite some time ago. Started working in actually not Salesforce, because as you probably know, Salesforce started off in 1999. And Mr. Benioff started it off in 1999 after leaving Oracle. I started my work life, and I still work in business service management, which is actually a bit related to Salesforce, since it also tries to monitor processes, guarantee processes in large but also smaller environments. Been working all over the world in relation to business service management. Couple of years later, so I started off as everybody does, as a junior consultant, became instructor after a while, because I like teaching. But not just teaching, doing projects, doing audits, and again, became senior. And in 2003, I started the second bullet on the slide, which is my business. So 2003, I started a company in Belgium. I'm originally Belgian, you know, the small dot in the center of Europe. Small enough to have our capital, Brussels. Brussels is part of Belgium, as you might know. So started off my business in 2003, became partner of, for instance, Hewlett Packard, HP, HP, they are quite big in business service management, but we're not here for business service management today, although it's very interesting as well. A couple of years later, I partnered with Salesforce. Yeah? And as you have noticed by now, I think that it's well understood that one of my main quotes is that an investment in knowledge always pays the best interest. It's a quote from Benjamin Franklin. Even ages ago, people already knew this. So as instructor, and again, it's not just instructing, but as an instructor, what do I teach? Basically all the clouds. Yeah? It's not just the platform, not just admin, not just admin advanced, not just the app builder trainings or the developer trainings, also the different cloud trainings. So I'm basically everywhere. Everywhere where Salesforce is, you will meet, so you will find me. Teaching different, I'm partnered globally with Salesforce, so with EMEA, APAC, and the other regions, travel the world, normally, not now. Since COVID, I'm stuck at home doing virtual sessions such as this one. So different languages as well, English, Dutch is my native language, French. So that's I always say teaching is my first love. But next to teaching, of course, I also do projects. I do audits of environments, and it's especially in audits, but also in teaching people that I found again that security is not well known enough. So it's really something that people need to or new admins and even experienced admins. Need to make sure they master well. Good. So that's my background. That's my business. Business is going well, even through COVID. I would almost say thanks to COVID, since the world has become more and more virtual. Distance doesn't count anymore. If you look at the Commerce Cloud in Salesforce, it has been booming, building web shops, building B2C, B2B, e-commerce sites has become extremely, extremely popular. Good. This one you already showed, I think, Sashi. I don't know that much about your program, but I'm sure these are very important URLs for you. So keep them, maybe.
Yeah, by Sashi. Following them, they may get updates for the future sessions.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. 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 So, if there's anything you have to add to one of the slides which are not mine, Sashi, I'm happy to interrupt me. Good. Same for this one. This is not one of my slides. So, Sashi, if there's anything to say, feel happy to interrupt me.
I have already told them, sir.
That's what I thought.
Yeah.
Okay, though. In that case, I'm racing on because we only have 1 hour.
Yeah.
Good. Security. So let's have a look at security. Yeah. As I said, it's low level, low entry, but I always tend to make things as easy as possible. Yeah. To analyze them down to a level where they become extremely easy. If I'm thinking about security, if I do an audit of an organization, there are two things which are important for me, and that's the security at the level of the user profile and the security at the level of the organization. If we look at the user profile, and we would have to define what we define in the user profile, these are two things. We have what the user can see. What the user can see is defined in the user settings, and what a user can do. What the user can do is defined in the permissions of a profile. Do not forget that user profile is extremely important. When we set up a profile, it takes me 1 minute sometimes, or a couple of minutes to set up a profile. But I should not forget that at that point, I'm actually defining what that user can see. I'm defining the portal to my data. So always keep in the back of your mind that you're defining the user's access to the data, and not just the action access, of course, also what the user can do. What the user can do is, if you look at it, basically defined in what we call the permissions. Remember, within Salesforce, we have the system permissions, we have the app permissions. That's what the user can do. I haven't mentioned the most important permissions, of course, yet, which are the object permissions, but we'll have a look at them in a few moments. And so just to make sure that everybody knows what I'm talking about, user profile, if you navigate the setup, the homepage, and you navigate to profiles, that's where you find the user profiles, of course. You already mentioned that or noticed that some of these profiles are deletable, others are not. Well, that's an easy way to double check whether a profile is custom or standard. We have custom profiles, of course, and we have standard profiles. And the rule that we have is never, ever, ever use standard profiles. I have this rule. I like global rules. I have this global rule that says, whenever something is standard in Salesforce, two things apply. Standard stuff you cannot delete. Whenever you're looking at the standard field, the standard object, the standard report, the standard report type, the standard whatever, whenever it says standard, it's undeletable. Why? Well, that's what the company paid for. That's what's part of the license. So standard stuff cannot be deleted. Second, standard stuff can only be partially modified. You can modify standard stuff, but you can't modify everything about standard components. And often this will lead to too much restrictions. For some entities, for some areas, it will impose too many restrictions. If you look at the user profile, a standard user profile, you cannot modify the standard object permissions. And that's a big problem. That's why we never, ever use standard profiles. So that's already one thing. Whenever you build a profile, build a custom one. Standard profiles can be modified, but that one of these most important things, the object permissions on standard objects cannot be modified, which in the end will always lead to people having too much access or too little access to certain objects, and we can't modify this. So that's not good at all. So we always clone them. And as you can see, some of these profiles are deletable. Well, these are, of course, custom profiles. I always have that good approach. I'll try not to talk too much about one topic. I'm monitoring the time. I always try to make sure that I have what we call a no access profile. Whenever I do an implementation at the customer site, my profiles are built based on a no access profile, guaranteeing that I don't assign too much access. You will find that in the best practices, Salesforce will recommend to clone a profile, a standard profile, and start modifying it. Dangerous. You can always forget, or you might always forget to take away certain permissions after you've cloned it. One more remark to these profiles. Of course, there's one profile that we do use, which is the system administrator profile. Yes, this profile is standard, but of course, since system administrator is full access, well, that profile is full access, and there's nothing to be modified about that profile. It's just a full access profile. So yes, we do use some predefined standard profiles. But the moment we have to introduce dynamics and make sure that you have a custom profile. Good. So that's the profile. Second part is, of course, how that profile connects to the data through the organization, the org. And for those of you, such as me, who have a technical background, it's pretty easy. You can compare Salesforce to a database. I'll tell you more. It is a database. It's an Oracle database in the background. So Salesforce is in the end nothing more than a very fancy SaaS, software as a service, a very nice SaaS database that we connect to. Yeah? So it is a database. And what's the structure of a database? Well, you have the organization, which is the database itself. Yeah? That's where we log on, the org. Yeah? Next level, the application, collection of tabs. Yeah? If you look at an organization, the organization has apps, of course. If I go to, just to make sure that everybody knows what I'm talking about, here we have these apps. And what are apps? They are nothing more than collections of tabs. Yeah? Within the app, we'll find different tabs. What's a tab? Well, there are two types of tabs. Yeah? You have tabs that represent a certain functionality. Let me just, for the show, let me move to the sales app. But if it wants to, it's early morning, so my laptop is still a bit lazy. Here you can see a very bad example of an app. It has lots of tabs in this case, so it should need to be modified, optimized. But there are two types of tabs. Look, we have files. The feature tab, it's some kind of feature which is represented by Salesforce. We have tasks, we have the calendar tab, we have the chatter tab. These are what I call feature tabs. Can we do something with them? Yes, a bit. We can modify the functionality a bit. Are they important? Yes, of course. It's important that people can create tasks. Do I work a lot with them? From an admin perspective, not really. Yeah. The tabs which I consider important are these ones, accounts, contacts, my object tabs. These are the tabs that represent an object. These are actually the tabs that represent my data. Okay, good. So we have the app contains tabs, feature tabs, important, but not my biggest concern. Object tabs, extremely important. They provide access to my object. Yeah. So in database terminology, the organization is the database. The object or the tab is the object, which is similar to the table in a database. And then we have the app. I often compare the app, for those of you who are technical, I often compare the app with a table space. If you know Oracle has table spaces are collections of, basically collections of tables, table spaces. And within a database, we need them for performance. They group related data tables, and they improve the performance of a database. Similar in Salesforce, they group tabs to improve the performance of the user. Not really the database in that case, but the user. User has all the related data together in one app. If we're talking sales, these are the objects that you need. Okay, so that's object level, table. And then, of course, every database has records and every database has fields. Records or instances representing the actual data. Every row is a record of data. And every record of data needs to be described, of course. Describing data is done using fields attributes within the tables. So it is, in the end, a database structure. How does security work? Well, the good news is, as it works for every different type of database, every individual component has its own security settings, except for one, app. That's already the first mix-up that I often see in admins, again, even experienced ones, the app itself. The app does not represent, at least from a real security perspective, it doesn't represent security. Yeah. It's if you let's put it this way: if you don't have access to an application as a user, it does not mean that you do not have access to the objects which are part of the application. Yeah? Object permissions are always ruling. Even though you can't see the sales app, you will still be able to access account, contact, and other information. Yeah? Because that information, the access at the object level is, of course, defined at object level. Okay, so the app, I don't consider too important. So which levels are important for security? Organization, object, record, field. Four levels I have always in the back of my mind. If I go back to my user interface, and if I try to apply this knowledge to the user interface or part of this knowledge, I have to go back to, the setup. And within the setup, again, users and profile. This is very important. If you work as an admin with Salesforce, this is a location that you will often navigate to. By the way, this is one of my demo organizations. So I can do whatever I want, even on an early Saturday morning, I can screw it up. No one will complain. You can see accounts receivable user, of course. For instance, if I open this, here you have it, object settings. Object settings, having all the objects that are available for this organization, including the custom objects, the ones that I created. If I open one, accounts, security is represented over here, as you can see. Okay, tab settings. I'm not going into the details, so that's for later on for yourself. Here you can see the object permissions. Here you can see the field permissions. So very important at user level. Okay. Give me 1 minute. Okay, good. Everything clear for everyone? I would almost say no questions, but I think it's a bit difficult to have questions because we are quite a lot of people, of course. So here you can see again. Give me 1 second, please. I'm going to close my window because someone is mowing the lawn. Okay, sorry for the interruption. Let's continue. Good. So here you can see these levels once more, that organization compared to a database. And again, it might all the things that I'm saying might seem simple, but that's the general idea. If you think, well, that's easy, well, that's simple, that's good, because that's how it needs to be. This needs to be low level understood. Okay. So here, another thing which is very important to realize, and again, if you explain it, it seems logical, but still, you can't access an object, of course, if you can't access the organization. So you need to have access at organization level before you can access an object. You need to be able to access an object before you can access the data which is stored within that object. Also, make sure that you're not confused between object level and record level. I notice that many people are. Yeah? There's a very important difference between object level access and record level access. Object only defines what you can do with the data in, or what you can do at the level of the object itself. Yeah? It in other words, it does not define your access level to the data. Yeah? That's record level. We'll explain in a bit more detail in a moment. So make a distinction between object and record level. Salesforce often compares this to a driver license. Yeah? You have a driver license. That driver license allows you to drive a car. You can drive, basically, you can drive any car. But of course, it will always depend on ownership. I can't just drive your car. I need the keys of that car. And that's record level access. The car itself is the record. The object is the driver permission, you see? So I need ownership. And ownership, or the keys, they represent ownership, or they represent sharing. Maybe you will give me the keys of the car and then you're sharing the car with me. You see, we share the record. Yeah. It also is similar for record and field level. It's not because you have access to the record that you will see all the fields within that record. Yeah. Does that make sense? Of course it does. I'm a sales rep. I'm allowed to create opportunities. I can edit opportunities. I can see all the fields of an opportunity, but I might not be able to see the credit card information. Credit card information is only viewable to my accounts receivable, to my finance department, you see? So yes, of course, it's important to have distinctions at field level as well. Good, so that's the organization compared to a database, okay? As I already discussed, that profile, it all starts with the profile. For me, the profile is what defines the base level of access for a user. Okay, so it is typically we have an organization. Within the organization, we have different departments. Before I continue, for me, a profile has a vertical and a horizontal component. Yeah? The horizontal component defines the hierarchy in the organization. We have reps, we have executives, we have VPs, we have the CEO, and so on. So they represent the vertical axis or the vertical layer. The horizontal. The vertical layers are the different departments. Yes, we have reps, representatives, and they are part of the sales department. Sales rep. Profile, you see, and then you have sales executive profile, and then you have support rep profile. So that a profile is, let's say, a section out of your organization, and that section is most of the time defined by a vertical and a horizontal component. Vertical component is the hierarchy in the organization. The other component is the department. That's the horizontal component. Or the other way around, doesn't matter. It's a section, combination between hierarchy within the organization, department that you work for. So what a user can see, what does that mean? If we say a profile defines what a user can see. Well, in that case, we're talking about which apps a user can see, which tabs a user can see. If I'm talking tabs, I'm actually talking objects, which objects a user can see, so which data, but also which page layouts a user can access, which record types a user can access. So the page layout is basically the way a record is represented on the user interface to a user, okay? I'm not sure whether everybody, just to give you a quick example, if I navigate Object Manager, where I can modify, personalize, customize objects, and I move to the account object, and I go to page layouts over here, I will find a couple of page layouts, a default account layout, but also a customer account layout dedicated to customer accounts and having a different content as the partner account layout. Typical example, a customer account might have support information. Our partners, resellers, they don't have a support contract with the organization, so there is no support information. So I make sure only fields which are important to that particular type of record type, are displayed. If I open this customer account layout, you basically see the structure of the detail page and the related lists of an object. Okay, good. So what the user can see, the record type is dynamic. If you don't know record types, there are a couple of things to remember. First of all, I'm a big fan of record types. They are extremely important. For me, one of the most important components of automation. So that's important to remember. Second, what are they? They are very similar to page layouts, but they will adjust basically the page layout based on the type of record. So the record type will ensure that I use the correct layout depending on the type of record I'm looking at. So when I'm looking at a, at the partner account, it makes sure that the partner account page layout is being used. When I'm looking at a customer account, the record type will make sure that it will use the customer account page layout. You see, it's similar to a page layout, but it introduces dynamics. And there's a lot more to tell about them. Yeah, but it's already a good start. Eh? It introduces dynamic page layouts. Good. Finally, of course, which fields on a page layout are visible is also defined in the user profile. So as you can see, do not underestimate this user profile. It defines basically the access a user has to the organization, literally what a user can see. Whenever I change one setting over there, I might impact hundreds of users. They will see different information than before, more or less information. It also defines what a user can do. What a user can do, system permissions, app permissions, object permissions. As you can see on this slide, compliant with what Salesforce does, by the way, I mentioned standard and custom object permissions. Actually, they are the same. Yeah? There is no difference between standard and custom object. They have the same type of permissions. We'll have a look at them in a moment. Again, to map this with the user interface, remember, if I go back to the profile, we're still talking profile, permissions, what the user can do. Let's use the executive user, for instance. If you look at app permissions, that's what you would find here, you see, app permissions. System permissions is what you can find here. For me, there is no difference between system and app permissions. For some reason, a developer's reason probably, or a point of view, Salesforce decided to put some of the permissions into app permissions. Most of them are part of system permissions. If you ask me why are these permissions app permissions, I have no clue. It would be much better if everything would be a system permission. There's no reason, as far as I see it, to have app permissions. They are very similar to this long list of system permissions. If I open these system permissions, as you can see, long list, very granular. Actually defines what the user can do. Yeah? If I would deselect over here, run report, well, that user cannot run a report anymore. Yeah? So again, what I can advise you is, if you have a blue Saturday or a blue Monday, or you have some time left, run through the list of permissions. Okay, you don't need to know it by heart, but make sure that you run through it. If someone asks you, can I switch off running of a report, and you've read this, then you know, I think it might be something that's part of the system permissions. You see, make sure that you have a hunch of what's in these permissions. Okay, similar to app permissions, by the way. If I go back here to previous page and I open the app permissions, you will find a surprisingly short list or shorter list of permission. As you can see, they are grouped by app, call center, so support, content, knowledge management. So they are focusing on a particular area. Yeah? That's the reason why they are app permissions. But again, as far as I'm concerned, put everything into system permissions. Well, that's what Salesforce should do. Good. I forgot, of course, the most important ones. Yeah? If I go back to the profile, let's do this once more. For me, I think the most frequently accessed location in Salesforce is object settings. In object settings, again, if I click accounts, for instance, and I click edit, this is where I find the object permissions. Extremely important. The main switch, yeah, the creds. So let's return to the slides. These are the creds. And as you can see, you know by now, I have these global rules, which are easy to remember. One of them is creds always win. Creds always win. What does that mean? Well, they always win. whatever level of access a user might seem to have at another level, data level, for instance, if that user has no creds for an object, no creds basically means I remove these creds, no read, create, edit, well, he will never or she will never be able to access any data. It's the main switch. Creds always win. As you can see, whatever data level access a user might seem to have, without the appropriate creds at object level, user will not be able to access the object's data. For me, very reassuring. I will give you an example. Finance department, payroll information, which is stored in my Salesforce database. I don't want my users to see what their colleagues are earning. I want to make sure that they never can access any payroll data. Well, I switch off the creds. Nobody has the creds for it, except for people that work for the finance department. You see, it's a very reassuring way to reassure that some or most of you, of the users in this case, cannot access any data ever of that particular object. Okay. Extremely important, the creds, they always win. If I go back here, you can also find a modify all. What is modify all? Well, that's me, administrator. As an administrator, I've got modify all. What does that mean? Well, it basically means that I can access all the data in the organization. Nothing is hidden for me. Yeah. Second, I can do whatever I want with that data. So that's interesting. Yeah, I often call it co-owner. I'm co-owner of all the data in the organization. What does that mean as well? You never touch that button. You never touch this button. Yeah. Why not? Because you make people co-owner of all the data in the organization. They can screw up the entire organization. This is a admin permission. Okay. You also have, let me rephrase. This is modify all at object level. So if I switch on modify all over here, it means that this user can access all the, so this executive user can access all the account data. Okay. So this is used for delegated administrators, for instance, people with limited access to the organization, but full access to accounts data. Yeah. As an administrator, I have modify all in my system permission. It's also defined as a system permission. Yeah. And if you have it as a system permission, it means that you have access to all the data in the organization. You also have that view all, as you can see. View all is often, again, given to people that are responsible for reporting, for instance. They report for the sales department, so they need to access all the sales data. But they can't edit, they can't delete, they can only see. Yeah? In order to create reports, they have to be able to access the data, all the data for a certain object. Another typical example is view all can also be assigned at system permission level. It means you have users which have full access to all the data in your organization, but they can only see it. So with ViewAll at organization level is used more often. And I've used it, for instance, for executive assistant. The executive assistant will create the reports for the CEO, for instance. Yeah? So in order to be able to create reports for the CEO, the executive assistant needs to be able to access all the data in the organization. So we'll have view all at system permission level, okay? Another example, and then I continue, view all at system permission level can also be given to people that audit. If you have an auditor in the organization, yeah, and an auditor needs to be able to see everything in order to audit. Yeah. Of course, can only see, auditors are often external people, so they are not allowed to change anything, delete anything, create anything, but they are able to see everything in order to audit. Okay. Good. So extremely important. Yeah. Krets. Yeah. So here you can, one more thing, remember Krets are defined at profile level, okay? Now, so we've discussed in general what we can define at profile level. Now let's quickly run through. I've seen that we have another 15 minutes left. Let's say 20 minutes left. Or let's see how much time we need. I mean, I can extend a bit if necessary. So we have the organism. Okay, thank you, Sashi. Here you can see, so let's run through the different levels of security or the different levels of the organization. And here you can see level one, the organization again. Remember the database itself. What can we consider? And before I continue, remember that I'm discussing security as it is defined within Salesforce in an embedded, in a native way. Of course, there are lots of extra stuff that you can do. We have apps on the App Exchange. We can develop, we can do all sorts of things. What I'm discussing is what can you do without any additional code, without any additional app? What are the default capabilities of Salesforce? Well, first of all, of course, we have credentials. You cannot log on to an organization if you don't have a username and password. That's access at the level of the organization. And we can tweak, we can tune that access a bit at the level of the user profile. If you look at the user profile, again, as you can see, profile is extremely important. Let's go back to this user profile. Scroll down a bit. No, not yet. Over here. Where am I? One more. Profile overview. That's better. If I scroll down, look, login hours, login IP ranges. I can restrict access with login hours. I can define when users are allowed to log on. Rubbish. Doesn't work well. Rarely used. So you can forget about it. Yeah. Why? Well, it's only interesting for organizations that are local, because these login hours are calculated at company hours. So it is calculated at the level of the company time zone, which is a restriction or a limitation. If you have an international business, you won't be able to use login hours. It's too limited, yeah. Because you would need, in some cases, you might need a couple of user profiles to cover the different time zones. But at some point, you can't, even additional user profiles won't help you anymore if you have an international organization. So login hours are not very often used. Yeah. I do use them to block people. For instance, I can define in these login hours, I can define no access on Saturday, no access on Sunday, for instance. So that's something that you might do with login hours. But to define whether a user can log in between 9 and 6 or 9 a.m. and 6 p.m. or a different hour, I never do. Yeah. What I do use a lot are IP ranges. That makes sense for my sensitive data. If I have users in again, sensitive data, if you're talking sensitive data, you're often talking finance. And that's always a nice example. I don't want my accounts payable, my accounts receivable users, when they are Sunday, when they are at home, drinking a nice cup of coffee, tea, in the couch back home. I don't want them to access my invoices at that time. So I want them to be in the organization. If they access sensitive data, they will do this when they are within the organization. So often you will find that the company network is defined as a login IP range for sensitive data. Accounts receivable, they can access the data whenever they are in the organization or through the VPN. I can register the VPN as well, of course, IP range. So login IP ranges, definitely used, definitely important. Okay, login hours. Forget, yeah. Not really rocket science. They're not flexible enough because calculated on company time zone. It would be more interesting when they would be calculated at the level of the user's time zone. You see, there's a difference between user and company time zone. But then again, there's an issue because a user can change his time zone. So there's always an issue with login hours, difficult to maintain. Good. So remember, that's the organization. Credentials, and we can reframe or we can limit users from accessing based on hours and IP ranges. But they at least need user credentials. Objects, again, we've already seen, creds always win. Creds are extremely important, often forgotten. Typical example is people, admins, developers, they create new objects, fancy stuff. They create apps, page layouts, everything that's needed to access the object. And they forget about one thing. They forget to set the creds at object level. Nobody can access. That would be the first complaint. Well, we've got a nice new app, but I can't see any object. I can't access them. Well, yeah. Did you think about assigning the creds to the users in the profiles? Typical example, typical, very often forgotten. Yeah. Then we have permission sets. Also, remember the permission set. I've put it over here together with the creds because permission sets are often used to extend a user's object in relation access in relation to a specific object. Yeah. So with a permission set, most of you will probably know them. We can extend the user's access. Yeah. At user level. So let's say all my sales reps are able to, let's say, create, read, and edit accounts, but they cannot delete accounts. Yeah. Often you will find this deletion of data is very sensitive. So we don't want everybody to be able to delete. Yeah. So we don't assign the delete with the creds. Except for that one power user. We have one power user who's allowed to delete accounts. Yeah. How can we make sure, because that power user is also using a sales rep profile, that only this user can delete? Well, if we would change the profile, it would be changed for all the users. With a permission set, which is very similar to the profile, you can see them over here. It's very similar to a profile. If I open one, you'll find a similar structure. With the permission set, I can assign just that one delete permission for the account, for instance, for a certain user. So I would assign that permission set to that power user. So it's on top of the user's profile. What is my rule? As you know by now, I've got these general rules. What is my rule for permission sets? I'm a big fan of permission sets to start with, but I use them as little as possible. Why as little as possible? Because they are exceptions. I don't like exceptions. Yeah? The more exceptions, the more difficult to manage, the more mistakes can be made. So try to avoid the use of permission sets. But I'm a big fan of them when they are needed, yeah? Because they give me that flexibility. Clear? So yes, interesting. Needed, yeah, but do not use them when you can use a profile. Yeah? So when you can use a pro, when you have to change, I will come back to that in a moment. So if you look at the bullets over here, so keep them small as well. Yeah? If you have a very intricate permission set that you need to assign to one user with very specific permissions, you will probably only use that permission set once. Yeah. So make sure they are very small. For instance, I would have a permission set delete account only for the deletion of accounts. Yeah? It means that I can reuse it probably for multiple users. So keep them small, make them flexible. Give them good names, make them descriptive. So you easily recognize what the permission set does. Also remember, they are cumulative. Yeah? Cumulative means a user can have multiple permission sets. The final access of a user is defined by the user's profile plus all the permission sets that have been assigned to that user. Okay. There's another thing that helps with permission sets. If a permission set or if you assign a permission set to, let's say, 20-30% of the users of a certain profile, reconsider your profiles. Probably there's a problem with your profile. You probably need two different profiles. So again, that rule, they are very interesting, but they are exceptions. And you only use them when needed. If you use them too much, you probably have an issue with your profiles. Okay. 2 years ago, I think in winter 2019, Salesforce introduced permission set groups as well. 1 second, please. A bit of hay fever. So permission set groups are basically collections of permission sets. Yeah? So they are like modules. You can combine multiple permission sets into a permission set group, which can be assigned to a user. There's more to tell about this, but since we are, let's say, running out of time, I'm gonna keep it to this. I'm gonna leave it here. So permission set groups, interesting. They also have muting permission sets. Muting permission sets. A regular permission set is always cumulative. It can't take away permissions. If you want to take away a permission, you need a muting permission set. Yeah? And permission set groups can work with muting permissions. Have a look at it. It's interesting, but for now, it's not used a lot. Okay? Let's continue. Record level. So we already have seen crets. Crets are at record, at object level, and they are the main switch. Yeah. Before I continue, let me have a quick look. It's 8:30 now, Shashi. Is it okay that I continue? Shashi, you there? I can't hear you, Shashi.
Sorry, sir. Yeah, one again.
Okay, it's okay that I continue because I know normally it was, okay, 7:30, 12 o'clock over there. So let me quickly check. Couple of slides left. But well, let's say 15 additional minutes, okay? Here you can see the record level. So we have seen object level, crets always win. What can we say about record? What's the difference? Well, first of all, when I visit an organization and I look at an organization, for me, in my head, there are two types of records. To make it easy, there are two big collections of records, two different types. One of these records are the records, or one type is the records for which I am the owner. The other ones are the records for which I'm not the owner. Yeah, you see, that's an easy way. Either I'm owner of record or I'm not the owner of record. Yeah. And then I can continue. When I'm the owner of record, I have special ownership privileges. Aha. They overrule. They are very important. Yeah. Crets will always win, but ownership privileges are very powerful as well. What are these owner privileges? Ownership? Well, you can see them on the slide. Vested. Plus change record type. So when I'm the owner of a record, I can always view it. I can always edit it. I can always decide to share it with someone or even transfer it. If I don't want to be the owner anymore, I can transfer it to another user. And I'm even allowed to delete it. These are the special ownership permissions. To be complete, I have added change record type. As an owner, I'm also allowed to change the record type. But the most important ones are the first five, the ones that are part of vested. Okay. But, and here you can see a very nice example of crets always win. Even when I'm the owner of the data, crets will still win. If I remove the D from the cret, if I remove the delete, even when I'm an owner, I will no longer be able to delete the record. You see, that's what I said before. Crets always win. They are the main switch. Whatever type of access you might seem to have at data level, this is data level, your crets will always overrule. If you don't have the delete at cret level or at object level, you will never be able to delete this data or data from Okay. Good. Let's continue. So, either yes, I'm owner.
We can continue.
Yes. Either I'm owner of a record, which gives me vested. But what with all the other records? The ones for which I'm not the owner? Well, we will apply some rules. A couple of rules, couple of layers that we have to discuss. Yeah? And the first layer is OWD. Again, so important. And sometimes I see fear in administrators' eyes when I start talking about organization-wide defaults. They don't really grasp what it does. Yeah? What is an organization-wide default? Well, whenever someone asks you what is the default level of access that can be given at data level for users, well, that's the OWD. Let me quickly show them to you. If I scroll down in my home and I open my security and I go to sharing settings, that's where we will find them. Voila, here you have all the objects. And if I click edit, as you can see, it says organization-wide sharing defaults. These are the organization, these are all the objects, including the custom. There are a couple of custom objects in this organization. And here you have the settings. You see, private, public read only, public read write. It's so simple. You can set it, by the way, for default internal access when you use a Salesforce portal, or default external access when you have an external site, external portal connecting to the organization. Yeah. Voila, these are the organization-wide defaults. So they can be public read-write. When it says public read-write, it actually means someone can read, someone can edit, and that's it. It will never give you vested. That's ownership. So with OWDs, you will never have share, transfer, delete. It's about viewing and editing. Clear? So it's other people data. Yeah? I can read, write other people data for a certain object. Or I only have read-only access. Yeah? Or I have private access. So basically, it's a very simple model. It's black or white. Yeah? It's closed or open. Yeah? It's positive or negative. Yeah? It means if you have public access, you can see all the data of an object. Everybody can see all the data in an object when it's public. And if it's read-write, can even edit. If it's private, only owners can see their own data. If you're not the owner of data, you won't be able to see that data. Clear? So it's a very simple model. You can either see or you can't see. Sometimes people ask me, why would you use private? What is the reason for private? Well, there's a very good reason. I already gave you an example. Accounts payable, accounts receivable, payroll information. But even opportunities with sales rep. Often technical people, they don't realize, but sales reps, when you're doing business, when they work on a bonus, when they get some fee when they win an opportunity, they don't want other sales reps to see their opportunities. They want to be in control of their own opportunity and not share it with anyone. Of course, even for opportunities, we need private. It depends on the business. It depends on how open or closed the business is. So private is very often used. And unfortunately, when I do audits of organizations, I often see sensitive data, which is public. To be honest, I often see all data is public. And there is another golden rule. If people have too much access, if your users have too much access, they will never come and tell you. They will never tell you, hey, Philip, can you give me less access? Because I have too many. They'll never do that. They will complain when they don't have enough access. So always make sure to give them less access, or if you doubt, give them the least level of access. Yeah? If they don't have enough, they will come and complain. Okay, they will ask you for additional access. Here you can see specific object settings. If you look at the organization-wide defaults, I'm not going into the details here. Just remember public and private are already important. And just remember that some access, some objects have specific levels of access. Transfer, for instance, for leads, transfer for cases. It's very important. It's because of the nature of this data. A case needs to be able to be escalated, for instance. That's why we can also share the right to transfer. Yeah. Also, we have, for instance, for contact. Where is it? Contact. Here it is. Controlled by parent. Controlled by parent basically means the level of access is controlled by the parent. Yeah. So it's inherited from the account in this case. Yeah. It makes sense. If I can access the account, I can see all the contacts on an account. Yeah. So these are specific settings. If you look at campaigns, so remember there are specific settings. You even have full access. There's again reason to this, business reasons, okay? Good. Controlled by parent, for those of you who are a bit more advanced, I have no idea how each and everyone's level of knowledge is, but controlled by parent is also the default for a master detail relationship. If you have parent-child relationships in your organization, which you will have, some of these will be master detail, and controlled by parent is the default, cannot be changed when you have master detail. Okay. There is one big problem. If we make data private, yeah, it means that also it's only the owner who can see his own data. Now you can imagine, our CEO is going to run a report on opportunities, a sales performance report. He needs to know the performance, the KPI of sales. And he will panic massively because his report is, or her report is empty. No data in it. Of course not. CEO is not owning the opportunities. Sales reps are owning the opportunities, and we can't see data that we don't own when we have a private setting. So we need to open up access. We need to make sure that our executives, our managers, responsibles have access to the data as well. One reason already, reporting. They can't report on data they don't own if we have a private setting. So what do we need to introduce? We need to open up our organization in a vertical way. What does that mean? We have to introduce a role hierarchy. Again, I consider everything important, but this is extremely important again. We have discussed ownership. Yeah. We have seen that ownership is powerful. It gives you vested. We also have mentioned before, remember, when an administrator has modify all, it basically means we are co-owner. We have vested on all the data, okay? Now, we move on to OWDs, OWDs can give you access. You can read, you can even edit, but you don't have vested. You are just, in this case, data is being shared, but you will never be able to share, transfer, delete data that you don't own. That's not defined in the OWDs. They only run up to public read write, view, edit. Role hierarchy, however, that's a different story. Look, co-ownership. The third way to become co-owner. Actually, the second way, because either you are owner, you have modify all, or you are in a role above the owner of the data. Sales executive can access all the data of the sales reps below him or her. Clear? I'll tell you more. Sales executive is co-owner of all the data below the executive in the role hierarchy. That's extremely important. Again, it sometimes makes me unhappy when I audit organizations and I realize they don't have a role hierarchy, or it's a messy role hierarchy. Nobody manages it. And they wonder why they have problems in the organization. They wonder why nobody can delete data. Well, you need to be in a role above someone in order to be able to delete that user's data. If you don't have a good role hierarchy, well, yeah, indeed, you will not be able to delete the data. Or the only user that can delete data is either the owner or admin. You see? So roles introduce co-ownership. They are mandatory. Does it need to be a complex role hierarchy? Nah, not at all. It needs to be an efficient role hierarchy, granting the right level of access to the users that are part of a role. Okay. There are a couple of, again, roles are fascinating. So they give you co-ownership. They also roll up, as you can see, roles roll up. What does that mean? Whatever one of my subordinates is able to do, I could do as well. Yeah. That's the roll-up functionality. Whatever my subordinates can do, I can do as well. This is tricky. We can go into details over here. Again, we don't have that much time. Actually, we are already too late, but never mind. A couple of more minutes. So roles roll up, but be careful. It means that if one of my subordinates asks finance to share his or her payroll information, I'll be able to access that information as well, because I am above that subordinate, of course. The moment that subordinate can access something, I can access it as well. So be careful. That's a tricky thing with roles. Everything is accessible if my subordinates can access it, unless I don't have the creds. You see, creds always win. If I've never been given creds to payroll information, I will never be able to access. Or in custom objects, look, grant access using hierarchies. This option over here is the roll-up functionality. Now, remember, I'm in edit mode. These are all standard objects. I can't switch it off. Roles always roll up unless I'm talking about custom objects. These five are custom objects, you see. For custom objects, I can decide to switch off the roll-up functionality, okay? Good. Let's continue. Final important part for me at data level is the sharing role. What we have seen so far is OWD, at the level of data at least, is OWD, organization-wide default. You either can access or you can't access data that you don't own, private or public. Then we have opened up vertically, because there were massive complaints from the management. They can't see data in their reports. So we opened up vertically, but we still need to have lateral access as well. And then we have two types of sharing roles, ownership-based sharing roles and criteria-based sharing roles. I'll give you an example of an ownership-based sharing role. Look at marketing. The marketing VP, marketing director, invests a lot of money in campaigns. How does a marketing manager or director, how does he or she measure performance? By measuring closed won opportunities. I invest a lot of money. It means that my return will be an increase in closed won opportunities, closed won deals. Can that marketing director measure this? Can that KPI be calculated? Of course not. It can be calculated, but not for that marketing director, because that marketing director cannot access the sales data. Yeah. So, of course, he or she can access all the marketing data, but not the sales data. So we need some form of lateral access. You see, that's an ownership-based sharing role. I want to be able to see all the data which is below the VP of sales, for instance. You see, ownership-based. Everything below the VP of sales, lateral access. This way, this marketing director can access, can calculate KPIs. I invest money, sales increases, won deals increases. Criteria-based sharing rules are very powerful as well. Criteria-based sharing rules, they allow me to use any field on a record to define access or not. Give you an example with accounts receivable. If you look at an opportunity, accounts receivable, they don't care about opportunities. It's not their business. That's sales and whatever, other people in the organization. Unless that opportunity is closed won. The moment an opportunity is closed won, these accounts receivable people, they need to be able to access it. They need to add purchase order information, contract information, all other kinds of financial stuff. So the moment an opportunity is closed one, and that's the criterion, yeah, they are able to edit opportunity. You see, that's a criteria-based sharing. Let me quickly show you. It's also in the sharing settings. If I navigate opportunities, I can also navigate objects over here. So I click sharing settings. It was a bit slow. If I navigate opportunities, where are they? Well, let me scroll. I don't have patience. Not opportunity pipelines. I know they are there somewhere, but I can't seem to find them, which is annoying. Ah, voila. You see, opportunity sharing role. Look, opportunity one equal true. Let's edit. Yeah. So if step one equals true, yeah, I'm granting access, read-write access to the role of accounts receivable. You see, that's an example of a criteria-based sharing role. Max level of access, view edit. Not vested, not ownership. It's a sharing role, not granting ownership, co-ownership. It also means that whenever an object is read-write, whenever an object is read-write, public read-write, sharing rules don't make sense. Okay. Good. And final type of sharing, but I'm going to leave that up to you to explore, is manual sharing. That's just sharing through the share button or through Teams account opportunity or case teams. Okay. Good. I think this is the last slide. Yep, but the time, perfect. Yeah, it's not so perfect. It's 20 minutes later, but hey, there's a lot to tell.
No problem, sir.
There's a lot to tell about Salesforce.
Yeah.
And I'm racing through. Believe me, I can easily spend half a day or more on this topic, on these topics. Here you can see a field level, lowest level. That's the easiest level. That's the same type of field access that you will find everywhere. A field is hidden, read only or read write. So even if you have access to the record, does not mean that you have access to all the data, all the fields that describe the record. So hidden, read only, read write. Voila. I hope it was a useful introduction. It's not an introduction. I hope it was a useful overview of security, native embedded security in relation to Salesforce. And I do hope that you remember everything and that you from now on will be able to definitely apply it and be able to understand it. There's more to tell about it, but I think I touched the core of security. And I hope it makes a better Salesforce world. And from now on, I see more organizations with correct security defined. Okay. It is mandatory, Monica. I just saw one question in the chat. I haven't been looking at the questions, because as you can see, even without questions, we are already late. But it's not, I will answer one question. It's not mandatory because it's a bit of a tricky one. Yeah. The role is mandatory, but there is one setting which means no role assigned. So yes, it is mandatory, but you can switch to no role assigned, which basically means, yeah, it's mandatory, but you can set an open. Then you have a floating user, Monica, but now I'm going to shut up. So thank you for this session. And I hope maybe we will see each other again at some point.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir. And one thing, sir, the Kahoot is there.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, I will share that code. 1 minute.
Okay. Okay. So I click the link.
Yeah, you have to give that code.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then that quiz.
I hope you have defined some good questions.
Yeah, some fine questions, sir.
We'll see.
I will share the screen.
I'm sharing the screen.
Okay, you have to stop, sir.
Ah, I have to stop. Okay, I understand.
Yeah.
So, okay. Where is my share? Stop.
I stopped that one, sir.
Oh yeah, I couldn't find the button. Because I was doing probably too much at the same time.
Yeah.
Okay, good luck all of you with the Kahoot.
We will wait for 1 minute.
Ze zijn nog een quiz aan het doen.
Okay, then I am logging the quiz. That is it, right? What is not type of action?
This is not security, huh?
I have figured from admin and app builder, sir.
You're measuring the soft skills.
And Deepika and everyone.
That's a better one, huh?
Yeah. Theater, right? And yeah, the scoreboard is like that only. And the last and final question, sir.
Easy.
Yeah, that's the player, right? And the third one is Vilakshmi. The second winner is Purnima. And Deepika won.
That one was already written in the stars, eh?
Sir,
I always saw Deepika.
One first onwards, yeah. Okay, Deepika, can you please share your mail ID?
Congratulations.
And congratulations. And please do follow everyone for the future sessions. And thank you very much, sir.
You're welcome. Maybe we'll meet again for we'll meet again for an additional session. Okay.
Sure, sir. In future we will meet again.
Certainly.
Yeah, and thank you very much for accepting this offer, sir.
You're welcome. Thank you. Thank you for the invitation, Sashi. Goodbye, everyone.
Guys, please follow the New Delhi Salesforce group Twitter handle and everything social handles. And the session recording will be uploaded in YouTube in a few days. And we will mention it in Twitter and LinkedIn also. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye. Have a nice weekend. Bye.
Nice to meet you.